Since it occurred August 23rd of 2006 in Elko, Nevada, it was the mud fire. When we initial attacked it, it was around 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We tied in with the division at the Snowball Ski Resort. The way we were running, we were attached kind of to the local Carlin engine. We also had a Type 4 engine from Carson City BLM. We had the Type 4 from the Elko BLM, and then we also had another Type 6 from the Kingman, Arizona BLM. So we were kind of a little task force put together, and the division wanted us to go out and see what we could do about possibly firing out either flanking or direct. Captains got together, the engine bosses got together, and made the decision that they were going to go up in the chase truck and scout it out, leaving the engine operators to be with the engines and the crews. As we were talking, the task force leader got on the radio and said, you know, we have this window to burn. We need to get up the road and head up and implement this burnout operation. I talked it over with the other engine operators and said, hey, well, I've been up this road. There's a couple of roads that spiderweb. I'll lead it up, being a Type 6 engine, a little smaller.
So I jumped in, and us being us, we had to be at the front of the pack, and we were going in there. And as soon as we were getting in, we could see the fire. Well, we were going, the roads weren't bad. They were just windy and stuff, and dirt roads. So as soon as we got in, we went through like a little narrow canyon. Then we found ourselves, we were on a mid-slope, one-track road going through.
We got to a point where we came out of a drainage, kind of went mid-slope and up to the ridge top. At that point, one of the engine operators from the Elko engine said, hey, Chris, do you see off to your left-hand side, do you see the fire? We could see off the left-hand side a saddle that the fire was starting to boil over. I said, yeah, I have eyes on it. And I just passed a turnaround area. The engines turned around there. I went up the road to turn around, and by the time I had turned around, the fire jumped the road behind me, cutting off my escape route to my safety zone. I had asked the Elko engine, can I get through that? And he said, no, I don't think you'd be able to make it. At that point, I decided I'm gonna go up. My escape route was gonna be back up the road to where the captains were, and that was gonna, and head to their safety zone. At that point, we proceeded up the road, and I got a call. I finally got a hold of my captain. My captain said, Chris, do not come up the road. We're getting hit hard by fire at this point. I've already committed up the road. I've got fire that has jumped the road behind me, and I cannot make it back to my safety zone. I need to come up to your guys'. He said, I need to get up there now, I believe, is what he said. And so I headed up the road and came up mid-slope almost to where the road came up to the top of the ridge, and I noticed the fire had jumped the road in front of me. So now I'm stuck in a drainage in a mid-slope road with fire below me and fire ahead of me. So now that I'm trapped in this mid-slope road, in this drainage, I had recognized a two-track that had gone up a spur ridge to the top of the ridge. And as I'm going up the road, I hear something that no operator of any engine wants to hear, the sound of a tire puncturing. This is as I'm going up the two track. I was in four-wheel drive low, and I just kind of kept going on the rim and got up to the top of the ridge. When I'd gotten up to the top of the ridge top, I had seen this, what looked to be like a radio repeater site off to the south of me. And the two track went right to where this repeater site was, which had a concrete building, a road that went all the way around it. It was kind of my golden safety zone. And at that point, there was a rock escarpment. One of the rocks gave way, and high-centered my vehicle on this rock escarpment. Now I'm stuck.
And we decided, well, there's no way we could get out. We kept trying to get out, shifting, trying to get out. And then that's when we decided we're going to have to abandon the trucks. This isn't going to be a safe spot. We're right at the edge, the top of this hill. I was getting, like, I didn't show it, but kept it to myself. I was getting a little panicky, like, because Chris, everybody, they stayed kind of calm, but then he started getting a little jumpy. I was like, wait, this doesn't happen all the time. I didn't really know what to do, so I kept following him, just being a new guy, following him.
At that point, this is where the adrenaline really set in. My firefighter, being his first year, 18 years old, I could tell he was starting to panic. I was starting to panic. My first thought was, okay, let's see if I can fire this off and around this engine and try to create a buffer, and maybe we can ride it out there.
Chris was doing his thing, getting his gear on. I was over there getting my gear on. I was getting fusees, filling my pockets up because I knew we were going to have to burn out. And Chris was getting the drip torch set up. And I went back and I started the pump up. And by that time, there's little spot fires getting here, 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 because it was all windy and the fire's already cooking up that hill where we just drove up.
At that point, I could barely even get the drip torch lit. The winds had come up with great intensity. By the time I did get the drip torch lit and I started down the road trying to fire off from our little road area first to anchor in, get some black in front of us in the approaching fire, the winds weren't in my favor and it just kept pretty much would blow it out. I couldn't get anything to take. Seeing that I wasn't going to probably get the engine burn out around the engine, I made the decision on foot to make it to the safety zone.
We weren't that far from the truck, about 100 feet, so he told me to go back, get the tools, and I went back, opened the side compartment, grabbed the tools, and just left it open. It was running, and by the time I came around the corner, the whole flame front came up the hill. That's when all the heat hit right there. That's when it singed all the back of my hair off and stuff right there. So that's when I was just trying to keep up with him and catch back up with him.
My goal was to fire out as I went along the two track to try to create a buffer and slick off, hoping that I'll have enough black where we can actually, won't take a lot of heat. Just trying, at this point, analytical decision-making was out the window. It was all intuitive. My engine boss, he was trying to give me some advice over the radio. I think at one point I told him, hey, Trent, I can't talk to you right now. I got to focus on trying to better the situation. And probably not his kind words, but I think that's what I had told him at one point on the radio. And as I kept trying to fire as we went, I couldn't really get anything to take. And every time I would get the grass lit, it would finger out. It wasn't really getting good consumption. There wasn't a continuous fuel bed anymore. It was a lot of dirt up top of this saddle. I tried lighting something on the back end of the saddle so that I could literally just with the wind so that I could create a big black kind of wag dodge style, create a escape fire. That's when I told Austin, I said, all right, we need to drop this pack. Our packs are just weighing us down. I said, grab your fire shelter, keep your tool with you. We need to make a run for it out of this saddle.
So I just dropped everything. By that time, it was all hot. My helmet blew off my head, went down the hill. I dropped my tool, everything, dropped my pack. So I just took my shelter out, and so did he. And we were still just going and running, trying to get away, trying to find a good safe zone. It was so hot while we were running. I just remember holding that shelter, and that plastic on there was getting soft and sticky on my fingers while we were running. Like all my burns didn't come from the fire, it's from the hot gases. And those hot gases, when they hit your face, and I'm sure a lot of people have experienced it, it's hard to breathe. It's just like you even get that if you're barbecuing or something, you open it up and those hot gases hit you. It's just hard to breathe.
We got to about where the knob was and we were taking a lot of heat. And I made the decision that we needed to deploy our shelter. We weren't going to make it. We had the slope was against us. The wind was against us. The fire was already bumping us. We were both taking considerable amount of heat. So at that point, I looked at my firefighter. I looked at Austin, and I said, "We need to deploy now." So I was able to create a black, clean black for us to deploy in on the lee side of this knob off the two track. So I was able to get something to take. So I had a black spot. I had the side all picked out that I wanted to deploy, and I had clean black. And I proceeded to open up my shelter. The plastic tab on it had broken off when I tried to rip it off. So I had taken my glove and put it underneath my armpit, and I also had my radio under my armpit. And got the wrapper off the shelter. Went to open the shelter, radio and glove drop. So I grabbed my radio instead of my glove, and I proceeded to get in the shelter from the ground. The winds were so great at that point that if I had tried the traditional way of stepping into my shelter and then falling to the ground, I believe my shelter probably would have been a kite. The winds were that great. And at that point, I looked over at my firefighter, and he still hadn't gotten in his fire shelter. He kind of just froze. And I was yelling at him, "Austin, get in your fire shelter." I kept yelling at him just to get in his fire shelter. And as I'm getting in, I'm on the ground, I'm rolling into my shelter, I'm trying to get him to see that I'm getting in my shelter. He needs to get into it in the small little area of black that I just burnt out that I created. He took a look at me, looked behind him, took a look at me again, and then bolted. I had to make the decision, do I do I follow him and try to get him into a shelter? And at that point, you know, the wind was so bad, my helmet blew off because of the wind, the gust of wind that hit me. Now I have no helmet, no glove. I have my glove on my left hand, but not on my right hand. I made the decision that my situation was deteriorating quick and I needed to be in that shelter. So I got in the shelter, screaming for Austin, hoping he can hear me, yelling for him to get in the shelter.
Where I saw him deploy at, he was yelling at me to try to deploy right there, and I don't know, I didn't like the spot he was at. Something gave me a little push, and I said, I just kept going. And I thought I could push it and make it farther than what I guess he might have thought that we could have done. And I just saw the fire and where he wanted to stop, and maybe I should have stopped and stayed with him just because he had more experience than me, but I used my own intuition and kept going and thought that my spot would be better for some reason. And I kept going down, but straight, but down, a little more downhill. I just had tunnel vision. I was set on going straight to that cement building. I had my mind set to it, and I wasn't going to stop. I jumped in a little sandy spot right there, and that's when I deployed right there. So I didn't take any of the water or anything, like the radio, like they tell you to. I didn't have none of that. I just jumped in, no helmet, no gloves. My hands were all burnt. It was windy. So I did the whole thing, shake it out, try to get it, jump in as best as I could with all the wind coming. Trying to get everything all situated, digging a hole for my face because it was so hot and I couldn't breathe and my whole face was burned up by that time, and just stayed in there. And so from the time I got in, from the time it hit, just because the field type it was in, sagebrush and grass, and it was so windy, it was about 5 minutes. It's just like the whole waiting thing. You're like, okay, I'm gonna get burned over, and you just keep thinking about it. And I don't know, you kind of get that weird smell, like the gases and whatnot. And then finally you feel it coming, you can hear it, it starts getting all loud, it sounds like freight trains going right by you. And all of a sudden, it hits you. And like you almost like see that little glow too up on top, and you got those little holes and stuff in your shelter, and you can see the glow and you can definitely feel it. It's hard to stay in that shelter because it gets so hot, but you just gotta keep thinking to yourself, it's 100 times hotter if you jump out. So that's the only thing that kept me in there. I was thinking, well, this is the only thing that's protecting me right now. I better stay in here. It seems like forever. I say 5 minutes, but it could have been a lot shorter, but when you're in there, it seems like forever.
Because once that wind hit, it kept wanting to lift the shelter. I had put my gloved hand over my non-gloved hand and was protecting my head and my ears with it. And I'm still yelling for Austin, can't get out on the radio. I just, that point, the flame front had hit me, and it was hot, but I knew it was bearable. I was able to take it. I knew that I was getting burned, but I just held down there, just kept thinking of my family, thinking of my fiance, and at that point, the flame front had just about blown over me. I immediately, it was like standing in front of an oven and full blast and someone shutting it. It was it cooled down tremendously. At that point, I took a peek. I could notice the dramatic temperature change. It went from unbearable to bearable real quickly. And there was still stuff burning around me. Some of the sage was still burning. I decided to stay in my shelter and a little longer. I could tell my hand was pretty hurting pretty badly. I could tell that my non-gloved hand was burned. I also could feel some small spots on my gloved hand that was starting to hurt too. I burned my elbows. I didn't realize that they were hurting because they were burned and did nerve damage, so I didn't really realize the extent of my injuries. I took another peek and I noticed it was easy. I could get out. I was in the shelter for roughly around probably 14, 15 minutes. At that point, I got out of the shelter, didn't see Austin anywhere, started to panic. I tried to get on the radio. It wasn't working at that point. Emotions overwhelmed me. I threw the radio down. I think I said a few choice words and threw the radio down, and I heard probably the best thing I'd heard going for me that whole time was the Bendix King beeping back on. I call it the Bendix King beep. It beeped back on because when I threw it down on the ground, it lodged the radio or the battery back in place, and I was able to get on the radio and make notification that I was okay. At that point, they had a helicopter looking for us, and I still couldn't find Austin. I got the helicopter finally came over to where our engine was parked on the other side of the saddle. Our lights were still on, the pump was still running. The engine actually made it through the flame front. I directed him to the south of the location where I was, told him that I was okay, but I'm missing my firefighter. He took one loop around and found out that Austin was just on the other side of the knob from where I deployed. I did a little hike around the knob and found Austin.
So I stayed in there about 20, 25 minutes, I'd say, maybe 30. I just kept doing the thing, reaching out, checking to see if it was cool, and it was still, my hands were burned, so I hurt trying to come out, so I just stayed in there to keep that cool off a little bit more until I could come out. By the time I could come out, I kind of just laid up, threw the shelter off and sat there and looked around thinking, what just happened? And then as soon as that, I was like, I gotta find Chris. So I jumped up, took off up the hill, trying to find him, and I found him. Finally, he was coming over the hill. He thought that I got killed, and I thought he got killed, and our captain thought we both got killed. So they're all coming in the truck looking for us, and like my captain said, he thought he was gonna just see me on the side of the road burned up somewhere. He didn't know. So he was kind of upset about that. But then me and Chris found each other, so we were happy that we were both still alive. And so we finally made it to the cement building that we were trying to get to after everything was done and gone. It was still hot. We were all burned up. I saw him. He had his hand up in his shirt like this, and I had mine like this, and trying to pull my collar up over my face because all smoke and dust, and it was still hot. And it kind of hurt. Then finally a helicopter found us and came and picked us up, and then flew us out to the highway. And that's when we met up with our captain, and then went to the hospital after that.